because customer success is such a new field, and as you'd said, there's no traditional training available in universities about it. There are a lot of people that find themselves in customer success roles and say, well, gosh, I'm doing what I'm doing, but how do I know whether there's a better way? We've been talking for some time about tech touch or digital customer success, but with the advent of ChatGPT and large language models, we're seeing a lot of change in the way that customer success teams operate. I'm always amazed at SaaS companies and their CS teams as to why they don't do more with customer data. And there are a couple of issues from my perspective. We're not training our MBA students to be data scientists or software developers, but we are training them to be super intelligent consumers of the increasingly complex and increasingly powerful tools that are out there.
Greetings and welcome to ScaleDale, the podcast dedicated to customer success. In each episode, we engage with a seasoned CS professional to dive into pivotal aspects of customer success. But today's episode is special. We are going to talk about education in customer success. As customer success becomes important, we all customer success professionals look for opportunities to either gain an entry into the business, learn more about it, or upskill ourselves. Have you ever wondered when will we be able to get an MBA program with specialization in customer success? There are MBA programs for every stream of corporate job, sales, marketing, HR, operations, systems, but not customer success yet. Today, I have someone who launched the first MBA program focused on customer success, Dr. Vijay Mehrotra. He's a professor of business analytics at the University of San Francisco, where he leads customer success management education initiative. Prior to becoming a faculty, Vijay worked for almost a decade as an analytics consultant, entrepreneur, executive. He's a PhD from Stanford University, and more importantly, a pioneer of customer success education. I have met him twice. I heard him at a panel in San Francisco, and I'm already a fan, somebody who has initiated this amazing initiative. He's also associated with CS certification programs for upskilling working professionals, and I would really love to hear more from him. Fantastic to have you on the podcast today, Vijay. You can hear with my fumbling and mumbling how excited I am. Thank you for coming.
It's great to be here. Thank you for having me. I appreciate the invitation.
Oh, I appreciate that you chose and you agreed to be part of the podcast. I have always wondered when will, customer success become part of the mainstream education. And I was so excited when I heard that in SF Customer Success Meetup. I was really, really excited that at least somebody has initiated it. I hope a lot more will follow. So tell me a little bit about you, Vijay. Like, how did you end up in customer success education with your journey in the industry?
Well, thank you for asking. It's been a very roundabout journey. I, as you said, I did my PhD at Stanford University in the engineering school, focused on operations research and probability theory. And I spent the next 11 years actually working in tech full time, doing what today we would call data science. But in the 1990s, data science was not a common term, and math was a four-letter word that we couldn't talk to our clients and our prospects about very much. But we developed competencies in a number of different industries and a number of different application use cases, and grew the company from three of us to 30 of us. And along the way, one of the things that we got really good at was implementing enterprise systems for which there was a strong machine learning or applied mathematics component, where you needed more than just a kind of well-trained generalist, but you actually needed some special expertise to deploy those kinds of systems. And eventually, when our company was acquired, I became VP of professional services for a venture-backed software company with a machine learning application for managing people within call centers. And I was really shocked at how unsuccessful so many of our customers were with getting value from our products. And my consultants would come back from implementations or site visits, and they'd say they don't have the right people. They didn't understand what they bought. They're not willing to change operational processes. Their HR practices are out of date. And all of those reasons prevented them from getting the value from the investment that they'd made in our product. And eventually I got engaged, got married, started a family, and became a college professor at a business school. And I thought that I was kind of far, far away from my days with software and software deployment. But in 2017, we redesigned our MBA program at the University of San Francisco. And in particular, I was asked to lead up a career initiative, something that our students would have choose and immerse in during their first year. And I spoke with many of my former students who all seemed to have a job title around customer success management. And I asked them, what is customer success management? And they explained how the SaaS model had really shifted the power from the vendor who, once they got your signature and got your check, was off to acquire the next set of customers in the on-premise days. But in the SaaS days, in a sense, we were earning your next contract every day. And the value that our initial sales team had promised was something that you, as a customer, wanted to capture before you're willing to commit to renewing your subscription or expanding what you're doing or taking on bigger chunks of a company's footprint. So suddenly customer success was this strange hybrid of technical support at some level, because our customer success teams are product experts, management consulting, because we were tasked to understand your business well enough to tell you how our product could create value within your business.
Correct.
Salespeople, because ultimately our goals were commercial. We were not completely altruistic. And I like to say organizational therapists, because we had to figure out what was happening in your company and what the dynamics were to drive that kind of change. So when my students had educated me about customer success, my former students, I immediately hearkened back to my days running professional services and implementations and realized, yes, the journey to capturing value doesn't end with implementation. It really starts with implementation.
Starts there, yeah.
And my former students who were working in the CS field within SaaS companies really encouraged me. They said, you should start this and we will help you reach out, build relationships, and kind of build a network for your program. And so for the last now 7 years, we've been training our MBA students. More than half of our full-time MBA students end up specializing in customer success during their first year and having an area where they're immersed in understanding CS, understanding SaaS, visiting companies, listening to speakers, going to workshops, and doing consulting projects with companies. And
wow,
that's really been a really exciting initiative that's taken on a life of its own. I'm really proud of what we've accomplished.
Well, you should be, Vijay. It's starting something which nobody has done in the world. It's in itself an extremely huge achievement. The way you have changed the trajectory of customer success education, I don't know if you realize it now, but I know that this is something that will be replicated across the world. The way MBA developed over the years, you know, starting in 1980s, I think that's when it started. So I think customer success is going to start now.
Well, you know, I think it's a really an exciting time, not just for customer success, but for the software industry in general.
Yes.
And, as software has gotten more and more deeply immersed in the way people do business, that sense of partnership between the software vendor and their customers is more and more interdependent and more strong. And customer success is really a linchpin to that.
Yes, yes. It's a center point to putting all of this together. A lot of people are now, customer success was one of the most sought after jobs on LinkedIn,
yes,
right? One of the top 10 sought after jobs, which means there are more and more people getting into this industry, unfortunately, without being able to learn the skills of it. So one part is, of course, doing a formal education, which you've already started. What about poor people like us, you know, who've been in the industry, are trying to learn from the job? But it would be great if there is some place where we could get certification. I know there are many courses and I know you are associated with some. I would really like you to talk a little about, you know, how working professionals who are not you know, for whom it's not possible to come to you and do an course at university there, but probably do it remotely or have a course where we can really, you know, upskill ourselves and learn the skills which are globally like world class.
Well, you know, we're at the University of San Francisco, we're big believers that education is a lifelong process. And yes, so in addition to our undergraduate programs and our graduate programs and our executive MBA program, we also have a really strong continuing education initiative where our alums, as well as members of the community, can come and take classes both live in person, but also online on a worldwide basis. And in particular, we have a series of courses partnered with an industry leader called Success Hacker, where we provide online training, both synchronous and asynchronous, for working professionals to get certified at many different levels around customer success management. And I would say that the people that take those classes fall into two categories. Either they're people looking to make a career change and have kind of followed the same information you have on LinkedIn that, hey, customer success is a growing dynamic field. Here's a way for me to get my feet wet and a way for me to get immersed in what this is and to demonstrate my commitment and my credibility by getting a certification and getting the knowledge that goes with that. So the group that's interested in changing careers and finding a toehold into customer success finds this to be a great first step. But additionally, because customer success is such a new field, and as you'd said, there's no traditional training available in universities about it, there are a lot of people that find themselves in customer success roles and say, well, gosh, I'm doing what I'm doing, but how do I know whether there's a better way? How do I know what kinds of standards and what kinds of principles and what kinds of practices I should adopt, or what kinds of things I should recommend to my management, my team? And so those people are also a really popular population in our customer success continuing education classes. And we find a lot of them will report back, hey, I learned this in class last night and I'm putting it to work today.
Awesome.
I learned this last week and now I'm working on my budget for next quarter and I've got a different way of thinking about it and a different way of presenting it. So we really take a lot of pride in that our online classes, our continuing ed classes around customer success are both things to help you get into the field as well as things to help you excel within the field once you're there.
Awesome, super. And I think this is so helpful because, you know, the entire definition of the role is so vague. It's like, you know, 10 people trying to touch an elephant from different places, and somebody believes support is customer success and somebody will take some other part of it. But unless it becomes mainstream in terms of, you know, customer success, people being upskilled and learning of this is my area and this is how you define customer success, and the understanding more towards SaaS. And I believe that all these courses and upskill will actually define that for the industry at large in general to be able to, you know, apply the best practices across.
The other piece I would add to that, because I think you're right on, the other piece I would add to that is that the field is evolving. As our technology evolves, as our management models evolve, and, you know, I think that there's always going to be a push around how can we create the same amount of value at lower cost? How can we create more value at our current cost levels? And I think we've been talking for some time about tech touch or digital customer success, but with the advent of ChatGPT and large language models, we're seeing a lot of change in the way that customer success teams operate. And I think that it's a really exciting time. There are lots of software tools that are designed to help make the customer facing experience as efficient and as effective as possible.
Absolutely.
As well as I think really interesting management practices, designing the customer journey with today's technology in mind. And another piece that's worth adding, I probably should have mentioned before, is and try to create community amongst your customers and create an environment where they're able to share best practices in an efficient way. All of that is sort of driving the evolution of customer success, which looks different than it did 5 years ago. and it'll look different 5 years from now.
So that poses another question, Vijay. A field which is evolving so quickly with, you know, the entire dynamics of sales process, marketing frameworks, all of this are changing and the new things are being developed in that area. How do you define a formal education program as in, you know, semesters and what needs to be taught and what needs to be put together, where the entire discipline itself is moving at such a fast pace?
No, I think that's a great comment and a great question. I'll give you a couple of thoughts, I think. First and foremost, we don't see ourselves as doing pure vocational training. We see ourselves as equipping our students to think analytically, to have a broad set of knowledge about the different functional areas within business and how they integrate and how they work together. In particular, to have skills with working with systems, working with data, and translating that data and any kind of mathematical models into things that have value and things that can be deployed. And so much of customer success is trying to understand what's happening with the customer without the benefit of being able to have a long conversation with each and every customer. So much of that is information coming to our CS teams and coming to our SaaS companies by way of their CRM. Way of their issue tracking system through support, through customer surveys and net promoter scores, through customer usage patterns. It's actually one of my predictions for how customer success is going to change with the advent of large language models for artificial intelligence is that in the past, perhaps we'd identified a handful of features and we track the usage of those features and try to then from there infer, is this a customer that's being successful? Is this a customer that's getting the value that we think they can get based on these features? And how likely are they from a commercial perspective to renew with us? But I think what we're going to see going forward is a lot more artificial intelligence examining and attacking that usage data and finding patterns that indicate positive outcomes and patterns that indicate negative outcomes before those renewal dates and expansion opportunities are upon us, so that the CS team and the organization as a whole can take action proactively.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And I'm always amazed at SaaS companies and their CS teams as to why they don't do more with customer data. And there are a couple of issues from my perspective. One is there's simply so much of it. There's so many different things that customers do. And by customers, we may have a whole army of people within an enterprise using your product.
Yes.
As well as not necessarily having a longitudinal view of that data, but rather having a current snapshot. So I see AI as really helping us to kind of find those patterns and find those indicators by combing through that massive usage data that we have and potentially driving different models for storing longitudinal data, because we'll have the value opportunity to analyze it in a way that we could.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think a lot of new age tools of CS are looking into it. A little bit of self-promotion, Zapscale is also trying to look into it since you started it. But I really do hope that, you know, the direction that you're going, technology is now so developed that it has empowered, you know, all the entrepreneurs that are in this area to sort of try to start looking into it and to be able to use data in the right way, to be able to create those predictions. There is an analytics out of it. So that I hope it's going to be interesting times in the recent future and see some amazing stuff coming out in the market.
Yeah, I think we're going to get smarter around how do we frame the questions and how do we examine the data. And so interestingly, that brings us full circle to what we're doing with education, which is we're not training our MBA students to be data scientists or software developers, but we are training them to be super intelligent consumers of the increasingly complex and increasingly powerful tools that are out there. And
amazing.
That I think to your original question of, you know, how do we keep track and how do we evolve our education for a profession that's evolving? I would argue that, in fact, our entire MBA curriculum needs to evolve as technology is evolving and changing the way we do business across all kinds of functional areas and across organizations, you know, in supply chains and in these kind of customer vendor type relationships. The dynamics of all of that are being, and it's not a new phenomenon. I think we feel like we've been digitizing for 50 years.
Yes.
But, we're in this next wave now of digital intelligence. And
yes,
how
correct.
Does our education shift, not just around customer success, but around marketing and operations and finance? It's a really exciting time, but it's also it's not a time where you can sit back on your laurels. I feel like we're constantly having to respond and innovate. Say that in a way that technologists have the fun part of the job. They get to invent the new futures. But for us as business educators, we're left to scramble and try to teach people how to manage in those new futures.
It's a challenging job being a teacher. When I was a student, I thought being a teacher was easy. But when I became a professor for a year, I realized, oh, this is the hardest job in the world. You have to work harder than every student. It's not easy to be a teacher. You have to keep educating yourself so much. So I completely appreciate the amount of effort it must have taken you to sort of design a program which is not being done in any other institution in the world and to put a structure to it and get it going. So what are the subjects that you are, you know, addressing? Like, I understand data science is part of data science and understanding it is one of the subjects. What other areas that you're covering in the formal education program?
Well, if you think of our education program as having being a kind of three-legged stool with a fourth hidden leg, the first leg is just traditional classroom curriculum. So our students, by the time that they start working on customer success, have completed all their core classes, ranging from business analytics, operations, accounting, marketing, finance, strategy, ethics and leadership. They've completed all of that. So we have them take a series of hand-picked classes, one that's just a fundamental 7-week introduction to customer success and software as a service. They learn about the economics of the business. They learn about how to think about the customer journey and the customer interaction, how to examine data about customer outcomes to try to be proactive, to try to identify proactive steps that can be taken. So that's very much a foundational class. And we benefit from being here in the Bay Area where we've got such a rich set of customer success thought leaders.
Yes, of course, of course.
The second leg of the stool is our kind of ongoing interaction with industry, as well as workshops and seminars and simulations and exercises that we do outside of the classroom around tips and tools and techniques that are relevant for customer success, all the way from sometimes we'll do improvisational theater exercises to teach you to be more present with your customer, all the way to panel discussions about how do sales and CS work together most effectively, because I think this line is very much blurred. So that's all out of the classroom, what we call co-curricular activities. And then the third piece of the puzzle is every student works on a consulting team with an industry client to work on a consulting project. And that's typically not, sometimes people will come to me and say, hey, I'm looking for some interns to do X, Y, and Z. Can your students do that for me? And I'll say, yes, as long as you hire them as summer interns, they're available to do whatever professional activities you want. But our consulting projects are really around how do we examine something within your environment, understand your environment, understand the issues, and come back and recommend, based on our own analysis, ways for you to do better. And those are highly value creating activities. I get rave reviews, and you know, virtually all the customers that we've worked with over the last 7 years are referenceable ones. And the students get a huge amount of value from that kind of experiential education. And then the fourth leg of the stool that's a bit more hidden is our students will very often spend summer internships with SaaS companies, and in many cases stay on and continue on part-time during their second year of business school, because that line between academic education and on-the-job training, from my perspective in the 21st century, is very blurry, and we need a lot of cross-pollination across
absolutely. Wonderful. Now, at this point, I really would like to tell all of my listeners, the University of San Francisco, the Customer Success Management Initiative, is currently searching for MBA student consulting projects with SaaS companies. And as Vijay just said, this would be an amazing opportunity for your company to have students in your company as summer internship. They could do a lot more with the background that they have. They're also looking for guest speakers and panelists to visit the campus and talk more about customer success. So if you're interested to be part of this community, you can respond to the URL in the link below.
Excellent.
All right, Vijay. So that was about formal education. I think this is an amazing opportunity for any company to have an opportunity to have students who are, you know, part of this education program to come and help them and, of course, find areas of improvement. So next step from formal education to the upskilling part of it, as you were talking about the Success Hacker program. So I would really like you to talk a little bit about that as to how people can benefit and what are the areas you covered in that and for what kind of people it would be extremely useful.
Well, I think that we look at certification and continuing education as having multiple levels. Foundational skills that really get you familiar with the vocabulary and familiar with the ways in which this is not a traditional role and what makes customer success unique. And then we add skills on top of that, like project management and change management and sales enablement and sales support and leadership. One of the things about a field that's growing this quickly is there isn't a deep bench of experienced leaders who've been in the field for a long time. And so our continuing ed efforts to train industry professionals are both, again, as I said earlier, to help people transition into customer success, but also people within customer success to continue to layer different competencies and broaden their perspective around driving best practices within their organizations.
Awesome. And can you talk a little bit about some of the people who have taken the program and the kind of, you know, implementations or actions they have taken in their businesses?
Well, I think that, you know, we've had entire teams come and take classes and reorganize their customer journeys around the ideas that they learned in the classes, as well as in some cases, organize their teams in such a way that the roles and responsibilities are best aligned with what they're trying to accomplish. I think one of the most fascinating things to me about customer success leadership is really thinking about what's unique to your business, your sales cycles, your implementation and deployment challenges, your ongoing activities, and where you, how you get from first value to next level of value. And I think that the combination of technology, industry, client size and target are such that there's so many unique ways to tackle those problems, and that those are very much creative leadership exercises, and often with great input from your team, who are the people closest to your customers and who understand the nitty-gritty and what's happening on the ground at the deepest level. And so I think that our education, our continuing education, does a really good job of giving people perspective on how to tackle that problem. And in particular, I think there's sometimes people on the outside looking in that think that each CSM should be all things to all people within their account.
Yeah.
And smaller companies and early stage companies, that often is the case by necessity. But I think understanding and recognizing where there are opportunities for structuring your team and your journey differently, as well as doing some of that by experimentation and learning and getting feedback, is all stuff that is better done and better executed by people who've gone through our certifications and our training, who've got a perspective outside of their own small box.
True. And, you know, it's important, of course, to experiment at work, but getting some guidance in terms of the direction of travel is extremely helpful, and you would shorten your journey of evolving into your work. So thank you, Vijay. Thanks a lot for, you know, this deep understanding of the industry, and especially on the education part. And I really hope, I'll make sure I send it to all my professor friends in India And whoever I can get in touch with, I will push them along with, of course, I'm sure a lot of CS professionals would be happy to know that this is happening. And I hope more and more universities reach out to you asking, Vijay, can you help us start a customer success program in our company or college? I hope that happens soon, because that will really help the overall industry to evolve faster.
And I think it's a really interesting time for the software industry. And the SaaS model has made acquiring customers faster and cheaper than ever. But the challenge is, how do we enable those customers to thrive? How do we turn them into raving references? How do we turn them into annuities who cheerfully renew with us year in and year out? And I think customer success as a philosophy, as well as a functional area, has a huge role to play long-term in a world like this one. The other thing I fully expect to see is a blurring between what we traditionally call sales and what we now call customer success. Because yes, the roles and responsibilities are multidimensional, and yet there is a huge value from a sales perspective of having the level of customer intimacy that a good CS team has, and figuring out how to leverage that value in a way that's equitable, in a way that's motivating and incentivizing for everybody involved, I think is a real challenge and a real kind of area to watch. One of the predictions I made a few years ago is expect to see more chief revenue officers coming from the customer success side.
Which is happening. Yes, slowly, but it's happening. But
you do see it pop up more and more often. And again, that requires a different mindset than a lot of customer success people come out of the traditional service function and find sales to be something that they're uncomfortable with. And I think that's going to be something that's got to change.
I should hope so. I do. I am a strong believer that, you know, CS should own the retention part of the funnel and maybe part of the upsells as well, because unless and until you are responsible for part of the revenue, you do not get enough. You have to bring something to the table to be able to become valuable in the whole organization structure. I hope that happens, but it's harder to put it into practice in terms of structure and everything else.
Yeah, as I said, this is all evolving pretty fast.
Yes. I hope we are, you know, I talk to a lot of people in podcasts, and I'm sure a lot of people are trying to put this piece together and to make it work in their organization. So I hope we get to hear some really successful case studies of how people have organized the revenue with CS function and sales function with the right kind of incentive structures. And I'm waiting to learn more when this becomes successful in some of the organizations.
Yes. And if you're out there listening, we'd love to have you come talk about what you're doing with our students.
Yes.
We're all ears. We learn as much from industry as our students take out to industry with them. And I think that's a really exciting part of education today, business education today, is how much we can learn from you as well.
On that note, thank you, Vijay. Thanks a lot for coming. And I think today was an exciting time for me, at least, I'm sure. And the formal education in CS is so essential for skill development, to equipping it with individuals with the expertise needed for effective customer engagement and problem solving. And Vijay, you've played a major role in formulating these elements of CS education worldwide. Thank you, Vijay. And thanks to all the listeners for joining us in today's podcast. If you would like to connect with Vijay on LinkedIn, I'll provide you links in the description. You would also have the link to probably join and request for being a guest speaker, panelist. If you're doing something amazing in CS, do reach out to Vijay on the link. It's important to share your knowledge. Thank you, Vijay. Thanks
so
a lot.
Take care. Have a great day.
Thank you, Vijay. If you like the podcast, please feel free to follow and subscribe to us. We are available on all major podcast platforms, including Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and YouTube. And see you in the next episode soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.